I've got two music superstars on the show tonight. Bono.
Good evening.
Taylor Swift.
Hi, Graham.
Which is good, because I finally get the chance to sing my U2 Taylor Swift mashup. Welcome to the show. Oh, and it's Halloween weekend. Ooh! Halloween, when those who have departed come back to haunt us. Yes, there's our glorious new leader making his first speech behind the now famous Downing Street lectern. Almost 4 feet high and made completely of wood. Rishi Sunak is our new Prime Minister. I wasn't just talking about that. One of the first things Sunak is going to do is squeeze the wealthy. Yeah. Pay your taxes, darling! Rishi does get accused of being out of touch with common people because, you know, he's so rich. But to be fair to him, this week he was spotted happily chatting away with someone who's a lot poorer than he is. Stunning vocals of Lady Blackbird. But first, she's the broadcaster and former Arsenal and England footballer whose powerful new memoir is How Not to Be Strong. Please welcome Alex Scott. Oh! Wowza! Wowza! You're amazing! Have a seat, dude! He's the Oscar-winning star of Theory of Everything, Les Mis, and Fantastic Beasts. It's Eddie Redmayne, everybody! Oh! Beautiful hello.
Hi, 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 hi.
Have you done really well? Have a seat, do! With hits like Shake It Off, Love Story, and Blank Space, this record-breaking singer-songwriter is one of the biggest pop stars in the world. It's... Taylor Swift, everybody! Four decades, he's won 22 Grammy Awards, and he's the lead singer of one of the world's biggest bands. It's Bono, everybody! Woo! Oh, yeah! Oh, yeah! Hello. Happy to see you. Oh, oh, oh. I was doing a hugging thing.
Hugging.
More hugging. Go. Say hello. Wow! Ooh. Oh, not a bad lineup. Not a bad one. Welcome all. So lovely to see you all. Yeah. And scrubbing up. Very nice. Nice.
Scrubbed up.
Let's start. So, Taylor and Bono, have you worked together? No.
Not yet. We're going to talk about it later.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. But no, but Bono, you did a very nice thing when Taylor got to Ireland.
I'm a Swiftie.
Yeah.
I'm a Swiftie. You know, we're highly aerial birds, you know. And over the years, we come, you know, we've bumped into each other and been friends.
He doesn't want to take credit for the fact that he's so nice. He sent me roses when I played in Dublin.
Yep.
So he doesn't want to take credit for doing
red nice roses.
Thing.
You know,
he's a truly great person.
You
know.
You send that picture. There you are. From your Irish fans are far on the edge. Adam.
Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah.
He's just that great and thoughtful. Just the best there is.
I better have a drink.
And here's the thing. So cheers. Bono and Taylor not work together, but weirdly, Taylor and Eddie, you have worked together.
We have.
Oh, wow, yeah.
It was a decade ago.
I once died in his arms in a screen test for Les Mis.
Oh, wow. I did not know this. Yeah, I did not know this.
There's a lot that people don't know about this story. Basically, I was auditioning for two roles in Les Mis, and I'd done a few auditions and gone to New York and whatever, and I think it had been established that I had more of a look of Cosette, but I had the range vocally of Eponine. So it was established that, like, I was there for a good time, not a long time. I wasn't gonna get this role. But they were like, you know, do you wanna come to London for one last screen test and you'll get to screen test with Eddie Redmayne? I'm like, this seems like an experience I wanna have in my life. You're like one of my favorite actors. You're so ridiculously talented. And I was like, so yeah, I'll go to London. Like,
yes, indeed.
I get there and they're like, okay, so we really wanna like make you look like Eponine. We're gonna try to do, it's the, you know, she wasn't like loaded. She had brown teeth, you know, like she didn't have a lot of money, so.
A 19th century street urchin.
Yeah, she, exactly. I'm trying to say it in a way that makes sense, but.
She didn't floss.
Exactly. So they were like, we're actually gonna paint your teeth brown for this. And I'm like, so you're gonna do that after I meet Eddie Redmayne, right? That's not something you do before. I get to meet people and then you do the brown teeth. I'm like, no, it's this is just everybody's gonna meet you with the brown teeth, and we're gonna like do like big circles under your eyes, like you're near death. And I was like, this has immediately become a nightmare for me. And so then I had, you know, you were so nice, but I think when I met you, I was like, it's so nice for me.
What was hilarious?
As you walked in as a 19th century French street urchin. And I was not expecting that, but my overwhelming memory of it, Taylor, was I'd just been to Pizza Express beforehand and I'd had some garlic dough balls.
Oh, God.
I thought we were going to be singing off with each other, you know, but they had us. Also, it was so weird because Taylor was dressed fully as Eponine and I was like in my tracksuit. And they had us on the floor, like singing sweet nothings into each other. And all I knew is I just had garlic bread.
And I had brown teeth.
It was like trying to show emotion
but
at the same time, not to punish you.
You were weeping, and I just thought it was because of how I looked. I felt so bad. You're like, I have to be close to her right now. This is, yeah.
Oh, this was not the method, no?
No.
That's nice to hear we were both struggling in that moment.
Exactly. It was a beautiful audition.
And Alex, I feel bad because now you nearly met Taylor once before.
Nearly. On Strictly Come Dancing, I got all the way to the quarterfinal, got booted out at that stage, obviously devastated, but when they told me the news, oh, next week's music act is Taylor Swift, I was like, seriously? I just need one more week. And they didn't even let me come back the following week.
We finally did it.
I was absolutely... But now, here we are.
Yeah!
Talking about Les Mis, Samantha Box,
yeah,
one of my closest friends. Oh, my I God. Went, never go to a karaoke bar with Samantha Box.
She's amazing.
I was up singing Lady Marmalade, thinking, giving it all I got, and then she just gets up, and then I was like, oh, yeah, I remember, I can't actually sing. I was embarrassed. But she's incredible.
Samantha Box, who was in Les Mis and is amazing, plays Elsa in Frozen, and I took my kids to go and see, and she got, and they got to meet Elsa in Frozen, and it was the best like sort of celeb name drop I've ever succeeded.
Can't talk about Frozen.
Oh no.
Yeah.
What happened? Right. What happened?
Came second in the Oscars to the song.
Wow.
Yeah.
So sorry.
My life is filled with frozen fractals all around. It's the best lyric. It's a great lyric. Mm. It was a great song.
Yeah, and you should listen to that, Bono. Let it go.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thanks. Let it go.
Very good.
Let him right up. That was a volley.
Very good. Look, Bono brings us his new memoir. Here it is, Surrender, 40 Songs, One Story. It's out on Tuesday, the 1st of November. And so was this, like a lot of people are bringing out books, was this a COVID project?
No, it started before that. I wanted to explain to my, you know, my friends, my family, especially our fans, but it was my family, what I've been doing with their life, kind of thing, because they, in many ways, permissioned me to be not just an artist traveling around the world, but as an activist traveling around the world. So I just, you know, we don't really talk about that stuff at the tea table, you know, at the dinner table. So I wrote it out, and it's the story of you two, and it's the story of, you know, these incredible people. It turns out the most interesting thing about me, or the most extraordinary thing about me, are the relationships that I'm in. And I met most of them in 1 week in Mount Temple Comprehensive School in Dublin. You know, I met the other three members of the band, and I started dating Ali the same week. So, wow. There you go. Yeah. That is extraordinary.
No, it is really cool. But the story of you and Ali is just amazing. That, you know, there you are at the beginning and here you still are. Was Ali cool with all the big stories? Like, there's a story about one of your very first dates. Oh, look at you.
Oh, wow.
One of your very first dates when you decided to take it upstairs. Do you know the story I'm talking about?
Yeah, I was just... I had a box room. Most, as you know, most houses in sort of suburban Dublin were two bedrooms and the box room in the house. And I was in the box room and I had it sort of minimalist, sort of enforced minimalist. So all white, no shade on the bulb, you know, just a naked bulb. Yeah. And I was telling her it was really an art gallery. And she's 16 or whatever. And I really didn't want her to meet my father, Bob. So I was on a half day, brought her home, brought her up to the bedroom. We were laying there on the bed, I would say. And and he gets a half day, my father, Bob, and he's like, "What? Where are you?" And I'm like, I said to Ali, she said, "What are we going to do?" I said, "Panic." She said, "I'm not going to panic." I said, "Get under the bed." I said, "I can't get under the bed." Get under the bed. She got under the bed. The dad comes in. "So what are you doing from school?" And I'm like, "It's a half day. It's Wednesday. Why are you home from work?" "Oh, yeah. Why are you in bed?" On the bed. And I said, "Oh, sick." Sick. "Oh, yeah." And for the tough man, he sits down on the bed.
Oh.
And he says, so how are you? What's going on at school? Are you okay? You okay?" And under the bed. Like, I was okay. Ali was living under two Houstons, and she would be for a very long time.
Oh, my God. I cannot wait for the film of your life.
I know.
Like, I want the movie now.
Oh, yeah, well.
And there will be some great... I love...
Eddie Redmayne.
There's a...
There's
some great pictures in the book. I love this. This is an early, very early gig. This must be at school, is it?
Oh, wow.
Who I love in this, who's absolutely loving this early U2 gig, is this woman here. Look at her. She is living her best life. Look at her.
Wow. Wow, that is... Look, Edge has got the hair brushed forward, getting a bit cool.
But, you know, everyone starts somewhere. We've got a very early gig of Taylor. This is you. Now, you haven't sold out.
Oh, yeah.
But they sold out. Do you remember this?
Yeah. This was a big deal for me. I was 14.
Ooh.
And it was an event called the Nashville Rubber Duck Race. And it is exactly as it sounds. They would put rubber ducks in the river.
Wow.
And see who won.
Wow.
And I was the official entertainment. As you can see, the banner is incredibly high concept. It just says it like it is, you know, like, brilliant. This is her name.
Did you play before the race or after the race?
Oh, you know what? That's a really good question. I think I blocked a lot of this out.
Okay, fair enough. I won't dwell. It might be triggering.
That was the whole crowd. The whole crowd is in the
shop. I can see three people there. Exactly. Yeah.
You know, they do look like fans of rubber duck racing.
Wow.
Now, the thing is, you know, lots of people were in bands dreaming of being successful, including Mr. Eddie Redmayne. What was the name of your band?
What?
You were in a band.
I may have been in a band. I spent 25 years covering that up.
Oh.
But I was in a band when I was about 18, 19. There were three of us in the band. It was called Blutonic.
Love it.
Incredible.
And
what sort of music? What sort of music?
Well, I'll tell you, it was sort of... I mean, I was quite sort of emo... I'm going to say rock, but actually it was pop. And the worst thing about it was the two other guys in the band were great singers, and I just sounded like a choir boy. It was disastrous. Like lots of harmonies, but like just
so
not...
much enunciation.
Exactly.
Really such incredible diction.
Some horrible
vibrato.
Then they're
like, "I hate you, Dad," and you're like,
"That is
sorry.
That was so good."
But did you do? You did gigs.
I don't think we ever did a gig, no. Didn't but I'm
you?
Just hoping That's you don't have any footage or any photographs.
Annoyingly, I don't. I'm sorry.
Oh. It never existed. Didn't you? It was never here. It never happened. It was but a dream.
Oh. And Alex, when they were kids dreaming of being singers, you were a kid. But now, what is this? Because I've got a picture of you in your arsehole strip here. Now, how old are you there?
At the stage where I really wanted a fringe, but I just had afro frizzy hair going on.
But am I right that when you got spotted, you didn't particularly want to be a footballer?
No, I used to play in a football cage at the end of my road with the boys, and then there was a referee in the local area was like, there's a women's team, Arsenal, I really want to take you down. And I was like, no, I'm totally fine. My mum had packed me a capri-sun for a packed lunch that day. I was like, I'm totally fine in this football cage. And she was like, no, we are taking you. And then I got signed to Arsenal when I was 8. Yeah, really early on.
What is a football cage?
A football cage?
Yeah.
It was just literally like four. There was concrete. It was just nothing in there. But for me, it was everything. It's where all the dreams started. Literally, you had cars either side of this football cage, and if the ball went out, the car would come along and pop it, and that would be the end of playtime. That, like, but like, see you tomorrow.
They should introduce that into professional football. I'd love that. Playing against a car.
I mean, my friends are so jealous that I'm getting to meet you because we just look at you as such an inspiration, like breaking through in such a male-dominated industry. Yes. You should be so proud of you.
As well, because you've done so much with the US national team when they've won and you've brought them
out
on stage. And we see that over here and we're like, that is it. How incredible is that? So we know you've always been behind supporting other women and leading the way. So thank you.
That's amazing.
We're having a love-in.
Now, Bono, in the book, your father, I mean, he's such a big character in this book, and you had an interesting relationship,
combative.
Yes. I mean, to the point where, tell them about when you flew him out for the stadium in America.
Oh, Texas.
Texas.
Yeah, Texas Spring, and my father, Bob, you know, and it's hard to impress. And I have him, it's the first time in America, and he's in Texas. I think it might be Dallas, somewhere like that. And it's a really loud, as you know, it's just that in Texas, it's like a 747 going over your head, the sound of the crowd, you know? And I thought, this will definitely impress him. And I had the lighting person ready to, when I introduced him, first time, not only in the United States, first time in the Lone Star State of Texas, my father, Bob. Light comes on at the mixing desk in this giant arena. And he raises his fist like this, you know, and it's part mischief here. But afterwards, he came in and his eyes were red and he put his hand out and I thought, oh my God, my father's gonna give me a real, this could go off. This is like a compliment. And I swallowed and he just said, you're very professional. Yeah, and that meant everything to him.
Yeah, and you knew it was a compliment.
Coming from sort of punk rock, professional, not one of the great adjectives, but from him, it was the great adjective.
Yeah.
And the book is full, as you'd imagine, of lots of names. There's world leaders, lots of rock stars. A name I wasn't expecting to find here, Frank Sinatra.
Yeah, I mean, Frank Sinatra's, it's just incredible, but is it, you know, he's another tough guy. I'm attracted to tough guys. He said I was the only man with an earring he was ever going to like. And, Edge and I wrote a song for him called Two Shots of Happy, One Shot of Sad, which I actually, in Palm Springs, we were drinking, very un-Italian situation, we were actually drinking tequila. He was drinking a margarita. And I sang him this song, which he sadly passed away before he got to record. If I can remember it, it went, two shots of happy, one shot of sad. You think I'm a good man, but I know I've been bad. Took me to a place, now I can't get back. One shot of happy, two shots of sad. Walk with me, baby, down a dead-end street. We were mixing the bitter with the sweet. Don't know what you've got till you can't get it back. One shot of happy, two shots of sad.
Wow!
We're all just like...
You have to sing it to talk about it.
I'm so glad you did.
Well, listen, it's an extraordinary story of not just a rock star, but a husband, a father, a philanthropist. It's called Surrender, and it's out on Tuesday. Bono, what a... Oh,
thank you.
Swifties, and I think there are some here. So Swifties rejoice because Taylor's new album, Midnight, it's out now. Yes, it is. I've got it here. Now, there are different ones, aren't there? Different ones.
Yes.
So I've got, which one have I got?
You've got the main version of it. That's the standard version of it.
Okay. Yeah. But there's a mahogany one?
Very hurtful.
I wanted to deal with, it's all about sleepless nights and what keeps you up at night and the hour of midnight. So if you'll see the back cover makes up 1/4 of a clock. If you get all four, it makes a whole clock.
That is a good way to sell four albums. Clever.
She's all four Beatles, isn't she?
All in one. And before we talk about it, let's just listen to a bit of the first single, Antihero.
I wake up screaming from dreaming. One day I'll watch as you're leaving. Cause you got tired of my scheming.
You mentioned that the midnights, the sleepless nights, 13 sleepless nights. Mm-hmm. And what sort of time span are the sleepless nights taken from in your life?
Throughout my life, I think probably after I was a teenager. I think that there's such intensity when you're up late at night. It's a concept album, and the main question is what keeps you up at night. So it's, you know, you could be up at night because you're reeling from just having met someone and you're falling for them, or you could be plotting revenge. You could be
garlic.
Yeah, you could be thinking about the time that they painted your teeth brown to meet Eddie Redmayne. You could be thinking about what could have been. You know, there's just so many possibilities. If you give that, like, if you think of that as like a creative writing prompt, which is what I did, that's where the album came from.
And this album couldn't have only, I mean, amazing reviews. You broke streaming records, and a lot of the rave reviews have asked the question, and it is a question, that the great songwriting on this album is part of it due to the fact that you've been doing this sort of strange work of re-recording your back catalogue. So it was like you were doing homework on songwriting.
I think so. I really do. I've been re-recording my first six albums because there was a thing that happened where I had wanted to own my work of my first six albums. And when I changed record labels, my first six albums were actually sold away from me. And so I decided to just... I just figured if I made them the first time, I can make them again.
I love it.
It's an amazing moment. It's an amazing moment.
But tell me this, is it working? Like, are radio stations playing the Taylor version?
Yes, one of the things I was most thankful for was there's a company of many stations in America called iHeart, and they have sworn to only play my new versions, and they've said that they'll switch it out for the old versions every time I put out a new version of a song, which is just like, it's so heartwarming to me because this is something that I care about, but I don't expect other people to care about it. It's something that's very personal to me, and it's a lot of work, but it's like, it's really fun and rewarding for me, and I can't believe people have actually gotten behind it the way they have.
And doing this, you know, going back over your old work, has led to this wonderful thing where, so All Too Well, as now, I know. It's now a short film.
Yes.
So it was a short song, then it was a longer song, and now it's a short film.
Okay, how do I shorten this? So basically, All Too Well was a song that came out originally on an album called Red, which came out in 2012. I always loved this song. It was never a single, but the fans really loved this song, and I had made the mistake of saying in an interview the truth, which is that it had started out as a 10-minute song with like 6 or 7 extra verses, and we had had to cut it down to the sort of 4.5-5 minute length that it ended up. My fans would not let it go. They were like, I'd be doing an interview for something else, albums later, and they'd be like, where's the 10-minute version? Where is it? So basically, for the re-record, I was like, I am going to put out the 10-minute version. I'm just gonna show them what it was. And you know what? I wanna tell a story that goes along with it visually that's more than a music video. I'd been directing my music videos for a while at this point, and writing and directing them was really fun for me. I just love it. It's a very natural extension of my storytelling. So I thought, I wanna make a short film and really do this song justice and also create a short film that stands on its own. So I was very lucky to be able to cast Sadie Sink and Dylan O'Brien to be these two young lovers. And I'm really, really, really proud of it.
It contains the whole song, but as I say, also dramatic scenes like this one.
You didn't even look at me once.
What are you talking about? I'm catching up with my friends.
Trust me, they were enthralled by you. Of course.
You're really making the entire night about you.
You didn't even look at me.
Holy shit. I can't. It's fucking selfish. It's literally like, it's so crazy. You're acting selfish. I'm saying you're acting selfish. Absolutely. Right now, that's exactly what's happening. Don't fucking look at me like that. That's so fucked up.
Wow. Ooh.
They're unreal.
Did you let the actors improvise those scenes, or were you writing that dialogue? How did that happen?
That was scripted out, but I always like to give people a take of ad-libbing and just say, okay, let's do it like it's scripted, but then like let's do like, you know, a freedom take where you get to do whatever, however you would interpret this and what you would add to it. I can't take full credit for that writing.
You clearly love this. Is this going to be a new string to your bow?
That would be such an honor. I would do anything to get to keep learning and keep growing in that world.
She takes up singing, she's going to take over the world.
So that is like what you just said there is basically an actor's dream, which is you've delivered a scene as scripted, and then when the director has faith in you enough to go, now one for like go play with it. Like it's the dream way of being directed. So
wow.
Please cast me.
Music.
Well, listen, you can watch Taylor's short film All Too Well on YouTube, and once again, the new album Midnight, that is out now. Redmayne is in a film, yes! It's called The Good Nurse. It's out now on Netflix. It is currently, you may not know this, it is currently number one in over 60 countries on Netflix. There you go. So people are liking it.
Nice!
So this is you and our good friend Jessica Chastain, and it is a true story.
It is. It's a true story about a man called Charlie Cullen, who may be the most prolific serial killer in American history. But more importantly, it's about the extraordinary woman, a woman called Amy Loughran, played by Jessica Chastain, who was an amazing nurse, a lovely, gentle woman who was incredibly, sort of adored this man, and then realised that he was doing horrific things. And it was through her brilliance and sort of empathy, really, that she was able to stop him when
the system
failed.
But it's also the story, though, of how he got away with it for so long.
Yeah, which is this guy was at 9 different hospitals over 10 years, killing people, and was moved on from hospital to hospital, even though they may have gleaned that he was doing it, principally because no one wanted to accept responsibility. So they were protecting their bottom line.
Whoa.
So in some ways, it's sort of an amazing advertisement for the NHS, because this is in America, by the way.
The NHS.
I tell you what, before we talk about it some more, let's watch a clip. This is you as Charlie. Jessica Chastain is hoping to get a confession out of you.
You know, I don't want to talk about Parkfield. It's...
Why not? Is it because what they're saying is true? Because, you know, I wouldn't care if you did those things. I mean, I could understand. You could explain.
Very good. Everyone all right. Everyone all right. No one spilled a drink. We're all good.
God, oh my God. That was a bit of a jump scare. Yeah.
No, like, I knew it was coming, and even I was like, oh.
No, we're just...
Is it true that Jessica Chastain did turn out to be the good nurse and that you had to learn skills?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So we were sent to nurse school.
Wow.
Like a couple of weeks.
Taylor loves a school.
That's so hard. They have such a hard job.
No,
and
it's
so amazing.
Yeah.
So, like, the massive thing, I mean, obviously, I had huge respect for nurses, but when, like, to be a nurse, you have to be great at science, mm-hmm. great at maths, you have to physically be incredibly strong, like moving bodies. And then you also have to be this, like, emotional conduit between, you know, doctors and families that are most vulnerable. Anyway, I'm a useless nurse, absolutely appalling nurse. I went to nurse school, totally failed, managed to, like, on the first, you know, we had a nurse watching every take, and after each take, you'd kind of go to, you'd slightly bypass the director to go to the nurse and check you did it all right. But in the first take, I was trying to sort of, you know, put a needle into something, and literally the first take of the entire film, I managed to sort of pin it straight through my thumb. So, yeah, useless nurse. Never call me in a crisis.
But very good actor, very good actor. And I don't want to trigger Bono here, but you have won an Oscar. I don't want to upset Bono in any way, but you have won an Oscar. So you win an Oscar, so you must feel top of the world. Yeah. You get a phone call the very next day.
Yeah, so basically, just before the Oscars, I was getting married and I wasn't working, so I did a... which makes like makes it sound like I'm excusing myself.
No,
I basically got cast in Thomas the Tank Engine, straight to DVD, one-off film, playing Ryan the Engine.
Oh, he's Ryan.
Yeah. Ryan, you know, yeah. Famous Ryan. There I am. That's Ryan.
He's the voice of that.
The voice of that guy.
Yeah.
And anyway, it was wonderful and it was great. But then the day after the Oscars, I got a call from my agent saying, they're releasing Thomas the Tank Engine today, and they wondered if they could put a sticker on saying, you know, starring Academy Award winner. and I remember The Sun writing a particularly unkind article about how I was following up my Oscar-winning
article. Unfair. Unfair. Just a reminder, Eddie's new film, The Good Nurse, it is streaming now on Netflix. OK. So much to talk about tonight. So much to talk about because Alex Scott has written her autobiography. I've got it here. How Not to Be Strong. And that is out now. And Alex, you've talked in the book you referenced that you've been asked to write your story before and you said no. Why no? Why yes now? Are you glad you waited?
I'm so glad I waited. I think I've had so many new chapters, exciting chapters in my life, and I've been on a personal journey of growth that has allowed me to actually detail with raw honesty everything that I've been through in my life. And I suppose listening to you guys as well, the story of your music, I suppose for me that was my way of telling my story in my own way through that book. And I don't know, I think looking back, that kid who started in the football cage, there's no way that I would have ever thought that I'd be able to sit and write my own book. One, being dyslexic, I struggled at school anyway. So to actually sit there and have that there is, for me, one of my proudest achievements.
Yeah. You also talk in the book, I mean, a bit like, you know, I was saying to Bono about, you know, sharing memories. That is, you know, it's your story, but you're telling, you know, bits of your life and not all of it's great. And your mom, like, your mom must be thrilled that you have told, that you have told her story.
Yeah, for me, I think a big thing was I wanted to write the book to finally set my mum free and for her to start living. And I think it was hard for her actually reading it because a lot of everything that I've gone through was trying to protect her and not tell her everything if I was struggling. So for her to read some of the stories was eye-opening for her, but I feel it's so magical that we're finally in the space now that we can continue this next chapter together.
Yeah. So, no, I mean, I can imagine she must be so proud of you and so thrilled that,
I straight away get emotional when I think about my mum because all I ever want for her is to be happy and be free, so that's why I done it.
Yeah. And we must mention the end of the book. The end of the book, it ends with the triumph of the lionesses at the Euros.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, there you are. You were... You know, like, you must have been thrilled, but a little bit of jealousy. And, has that changed the game entirely now?
Oh, huge. It was like the 99ers in America when they won the World Cup at the Rose Bowl. That changed absolutely everything for them. And the momentum we have seen off the back of that. You say jealousy. Actually, I felt like I was that big sister. I was crying and like a baby. I remember Gabby Logan trying to ask me a question. I was like, I can't speak, Gabby. Like, I was so emotional in that moment. But I had a final chapter and it was a letter to my mum was the final chapter in the book. And as soon as that happened, I was like, sorry, Mum, there's another chapter coming in.
And Alex, football fans, you know, as we know, they are passionate.
They are.
But they sometimes don't have the best reputation. Are fans of women's football, are they better behaved?
I would say so. I feel blessed in that sense. I think for me, they've followed my journey from that 10-year-old with the frizzy fringe, Afro fringe going on, to that football career and into broadcasting. So I feel they've followed my whole story and actually been on that journey with me. So when they stop me in the street and they're talking about, I feel their passion and I'm just so thankful that they're still supporting me, really.
Yeah. Mm. And the... Yeah.
Thank you.
Taylor, you know, we've talked about the Swifties and how much they love you, and fans sometimes find unlikely things. Like, I think in Canada, by accident, a track from 1989 was released, but it wasn't a real track, it was 8 seconds of static.
Yes, this happened maybe 7 or 8 years ago. Yeah.
And what happened to that track that was 8 seconds of static?
It went number one. I don't know how, but maybe it's some metaphor, some symbolism about the sounds of silence and having a moment of quiet.
I love someone trying to present a chart show in Canada and going, and now it's number one.
It was ridiculous. I don't know why I'm this lucky and have them doing stuff like that for me.
But now, Eddie, now your fans have a special name, don't they?
Some people call themselves red maniacs. I think.
Yeah. There you go. Redheads.
Yes.
Yeah.
But I have lovely fans. But there was a thing recently at a Fantastic Beasts premiere, and I was walking to the premiere, and this lady came up to me and she said, "Draw on my arm," and I said, "Okay." Well, she shoved a pen in my hand. She was like, "Draw a Fantastic Beast on my arm." And
I was like, you know where this is going.
There's a character in Fantastic Beast called Picket, who's a little stick insect. And so I did what was basically a stick man whilst moving. And sort of and then thought nothing of it. And then the next day it went online that she'd had that tattooed onto her arm, which, you know, had I known, I would have stopped for a minute to make sure my little twig man looked slightly better than a... sick man, because there is an appreciation. So there's a low point.
And talking of fans, in the book, Bono, one of the people you meet is the Pope. And I love the Pope. The Pope was jealous of you, Bono.
I wouldn't have put it like that. If you mean he coveted my sunglasses.
He
is
did.
Is that what you're saying?
Well, no, because he was checking you out. Well, but not in that way.
We were there. It was, look, an extra, according to the World Bank, an extra 54 million kids went to school in the poorest countries in the world because of the Drop the Debt campaign. A lot of it led from these United Kingdom here.
Yeah.
But around the world. And that's what we were there. It was me, Bob Geldof, Quincy Jones, Jeffrey Sachs, there's a bunch of us, and this very frail man. And I noticed him looking at me, and I thought, like, every, you know, we're all narcissists, you know, navel gazers. And I moved, and his eyes kept going with me. I said, that's a bit mad. Maybe it's the glasses. So I took them off, because I had these kind of blue shades. And then he started looking at them in my hand. So when I went to His Holiness John Paul, I said, do you want my glasses? And when I went up to meet him, and he said, yes. And he put them on. And he put them on. I'm like, this is unbelievable. Swap them for some rosary beads, put them on. And I'm thinking, this is Drop the Debt, the Jubilee 2000 campaign on every newspaper. We've made it. You know, this is just one of those photographs. And I hear a voice in the background, and it goes, you will never see that photograph. Ever. But guess what? The photograph.
Oh, wow.
It exists.
So we now have, so this is the picture of the Pope wearing Bono's sunglasses. Right. Here we go.
Wow! That is amazing.
And that's Jared Mark.
I love it.
Yeah.
He's loving it. He's loving it.
That is cool.
Big yucks, big yucks. And Alex, of course, the next big tournament, World Cup in Qatar, you are part of the commentary team.
Yes, I fly out in a couple of weeks, so I'm going to be over there for a month. It's super exciting.
And what's the vibe like? I mean, are you worried about it, or do you think it's going to change that country for good? What's your take on it?
To be honest, I still don't know at the moment my kind of take on it, because obviously that's where things are bigger than football, and it's how can I use my platform in that moment to spread a message, make people aware, and not just sit there and think everything's all right when it isn't. And I know my role and the importance of that.
Yeah, it's going to be it's a tricky one to do.
It's
hard. And very quickly, we must mention, you are doing Children in Need again
next month. I am, yes. Next month. You're not doing it with... I remember last year doing it with you.
I know. This year we're like, I know, I can't be there this year, but good luck with that.
Thank you very much.
And Alex...
He's like, it's on your own. You go do it.
I'll think of a reason soon. Evelyn, good luck with that. And Alex's book, How Not to Be Strong, is available now.
Yes.
It's time for music. This critically acclaimed singer is taking the world by storm with her debut album, Black Acid Soul. Here performing her latest single, Feel It Comin, it is Lady Blackbird!
Like in every great fable, there's a moment when we all must learn to call, and when life has turned the table, before we rise, we know we all must take a fall. In this moment, ain't no different. Times are changing like the clock upon the wall. Wealth can come from just a dime. We ain't broke, I feel it coming. Don't we all? Such a lady, Mama said, son, you ain't born to be a girl. And in this moment, ain't no different. Times are changing like the clock upon the wall. The world is changing all the time. it coming. Don't we all? I feel it coming like the dawning of the day. Straight through the midnight while we dance the night away. A great big expression, happy on my face.
I would urge you to fight the temptation to put one in the back of the net.
top corner.
Top corner. that is so gorgeous.
Thank you.
Really, the voice. That single is from the deluxe album of Black Acid Soul. This is Black Acid Soul. The deluxe came out today. Is that right? That's right.
Today.
Yeah. Very good.
And you guys are all incredible. I'm so happy right now. I can't even believe it. I'm trying to be so cool, and I'm failing epically. I'm failing so bad. No, I know I'm blushing. And
we're the fan. It's the fan club over here.
Yeah,
you're
seriously
amazing.
And listen,
I'm dying. Thank
we got
you.
Vulnerable.
I know that people watching that performance will want to go and see you, and you are. You're touring here?
We start the tour Saturday. We're in the Netherlands, and we hit the Netherlands, we hit Spain, we hit Rome, Germany, Paris, and then we end up...
No Ireland?
Back... I know.
Not yet.
In fairness, Bono, we haven't heard about the UK yet.
If Bono wants Ireland, we're going to Ireland.
Okay. Yeah.
If Bono wants Mars, we're going to Mars. We end here in we play Manchester, we play the Barbican, Barking, and we end Joe Wiley radio. Yeah.
Google Lady Blackbird, you'll find.
I'm so nervous. Don't trust me on the date.
No. But people would be delighted to know you're performing new music and you're out there in the world. I have to ask contractually, Taylor Swift. When can we expect to see you on a?
Yeah.
I'm going to say that first you should purchase tickets to go see Lady Blackbird.
Yep.
But soon. Yeah, it's soon.
This year? No, next year.
I mean, it's soon-ish. It's going to happen. We'll do it. It's going to be great.
yeah, whatever. But Bono, you two, you're doing new music, aren't you?
Yeah, we have a sort of... We have an album nearly finished called Songs of Ascent. It's beautiful, but it's just not right for the moment we're in. We want to make a really unreasonable guitar record, a real proper rock and roll, you know, proper.
Hey!
And that's... So we're starting again.
All right. Well, listen, we look forward to that. Lady Blackbird, thank you so much for that beautiful performance.
Yes,
congratulations on the album Black Acid Soul, and thank good you. Luck with the tour. Thank Lady you. Blackbird! Sadly, no time for red chairs tonight, so it just remains for me to say a huge thank you to all of my guests tonight. Lady Blackbird! Alex Scott! Eddie Redmayne! Taylor Swift! And Bono! Join me next week with UK rapper Loyal Carner, comedian and writer Richard Ayoade, two of the hottest young actors around, Emma Corrin and Paul Mescal, and from the new Black Panther movie, Wakanda Forever, we've got Winston Duke and Michaela Cole. I'll see you then. Good night, everybody. Bye-bye.
So we're following England's Women's Rugby League squad as they build up to the biggest competition of their lives, Women of Steel. Press red now. Next up, pop royalty is in the building. Mel B joins RuPaul's Drag Race UK. It's next.